Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the Santa Barbara Nutrients YouTube channel. Today, we have Diana Bruen with us. So Diana is a registered dietitian and a renal nutrition expert. She's the founder of the PKD Dietitian, where she provides nutrition therapy and education to patients with CKD and PKD. And Diana received her master's degree in nutrition and health promotion from Simmons College and has been a dietitian for over 14 years. So she has a lot of expertise in this area. Diana focuses on proactive nutrition for PKD and kidney health. So her research interests include plant-focused ketogenic therapies, pain modification through dietary intervention, and a plant-based diet for chronic kidney disease and polycystic kidney disease. Diana also runs the PKD Nutrition Academy, which is a learning hub for all things PKD and nutrition related. Her vision is to bring science-based nutrition and education for PKD community on a wider scale with easier access for all. So some of you might recognize Diana from the Renew program. So she was actually one of the lead program facilitators of the Renew program in the very beginning of the development. For those of you who don't know, the Renew program is a plant-based low oxalate nutrition program for people with polycystic kidney disease, and it was developed by polycystic kidney disease researchers and renal nutrition experts. And Diana is also part of the Santa Barbara Nutrients team, so we're very lucky to have her on our team. So welcome back, Diana. We're so happy to have you here on our YouTube channel again. If you can go ahead and we'll just dive right into what are plant-based proteins?
Simply put, they're proteins that come from a plant source. So they're not coming from any animal product. It really is that simple.
Wow. So it's just exactly how it sounds. Mm-hmm. So plant-based proteins don't come from animal sources.
Right.
So when we're thinking of plant-based proteins, what are some of the top ones that maybe, you know, come to mind if we're pairing this together with kidney disease, right? So some of the plant-based proteins tend to have oxalates, and maybe you can just briefly explain what those are. But what are plant-based proteins that might be appropriate for those with kidney disease and have a lower oxalate intake?
Good question. To put the proteins in perspective, there's three main protein sources in our diets. The first is animal protein. The second is what we're talking about today, plant-based protein. And then the third is what I call product protein, those bars, powders, and stuff that are not, they're basically on the shelf in your grocery store. Now, when we're talking about oxalates and plant-based protein, it's important to know actually what an oxalate is. It is a compound that is found only in plants. And so therefore, we can take out, it's not in animal proteins, and it can be in those processed proteins. Now, oxalates are what I like to call a non-nutrient, meaning as humans, we don't need them. So pretty much anything that comes from a plant that we eat is going to have some oxalate in it. The plants need it, and again, we don't need it. And so what's important is there's different ranges of how much oxalate is in plant proteins. So having plant proteins in your diet is really beneficial for many, many, many reasons. But having an awareness of which ones, if you need to limit oxalates or higher in oxalates, mm-hmm. will actually help you out a lot. And a lot of the populations within kidney disease that need to be aware of the oxalate loads in plant proteins are those that have had kidney stones, primarily calcium oxalate stones, mm-hmm. Also people who have pretty decreased kidney function, because we don't want those oxalate crystals clanking around in their kidneys. And then people with PKD benefit right. from managing their oxalates from the plant proteins to reduce their kidney stressors.
Okay, interesting. So it sounds like there's, you know, obviously we don't need it, right? It just comes with these plant-based proteins. And so it's important, like Diana mentioned, to kind of be aware of the oxalate content in those, specifically if you have kidney disease or kidney stones, maybe a predisposition to those as well, since they are known to kind of, you know, aid in that development of kidney stones. So what are some examples, Diana, if we're kind of focusing on kidney disease, of plant-based proteins that are lower in oxalates?
So you're going to have nuts, nut butters, seeds, and seed butters. Also, you're going to have tofu. You're going to have lentils. Lentils, all different colors of them, are low in oxalates. Some of the grains, if you're not following a ketogenic diet, are also low in oxalates and have good protein in them. And so some of the examples are chickpeas are one of my favorite legumes, super low in oxalates. Another one that can be used is, they call them cowboy beans and black-eyed peas and even some refried beans. And so there's quite a few. So it's learning which ones have less oxalate. And then also for nuts and nut butters, the one I would absolutely avoid is anything almond. I wouldn't limit cashew because those tend to be higher. And every other nut you can look at and say, well, how much does it have and what is a good portion? So pecans and walnuts, those are great options. And then also both the seeds are very low in oxalates. So that's, you've got pumpkin seeds, you've got sunflower seeds, and you've also got chia seeds and hemp seeds. And so lots of different options. And you can't do a oxalate-free diet because it's in plant food. That would just be a very unhealthy diet.
Okay. Yeah, that's actually really important to kind of note. So I guess with the oxalates, right, we're going to have those anyways if we're eating plant-based. Anybody actually would probably have those at some point of the day when they're eating something. So is there a daily range maybe that someone should look out for limiting oxalate intake for someone particularly who has kidney stones or kidney disease?
Right. And so, well, the average person gets around 300 milligrams of oxalates in their diet each day. And if someone has kidney stones and their calcium oxalate stones, because it's important to know what type of stone, a general recommendation is 100 or less a day. And if someone has recurrent, really bad kidney stones, a lot of times you'll hear 50 or less a day. So if you're doing proactive nutrition specifically for PKD, I like to say let's aim for less than 100 a day. And it's very easy to do once you know which plant proteins or plant sources you gotta, you know, limit and pay attention to. But the cool thing about oxalates and plant proteins is what you're eating is not always what you're absorbing. But that's a discussion for a whole other day.
Yes. I was going to talk about kind of the bioavailability of these plant-based proteins, right? What is that? And so with these numbers and, you know, I will go ahead and we'll attach kind of something down at the bottom of this video too that will help individuals take a look at, you know, foods that are maybe high, medium, or low in oxalates just based off interest and then also serving size too. So I think that's important to look for. So we're talking about all of this, you know, oxalate intake or plant-based proteins and kidney disease. Maybe you can just briefly talk about what some of the research has shown for, you know, plant-based proteins and kidney disease as opposed to animal-based proteins for those with kidney
disease. Absolutely. Protein is a hot topic of conversation, and I love talking about it. And here's what you really want to know: the type of protein that you are consuming and the amount, both matter. And when I say type, that goes back to the animal source, plant source, or the product source. And why is protein connected with kidney talk all the time? Here's why. Protein, what we eat, is the number one stressor on our kidneys. It provides the most work for our kidneys. So clearly, if your kidneys aren't working at full function, we don't want to stress them out anymore. Right. And so in a simple way to connect it is that high protein is more work, more stress, more waste on the kidneys. And that's exactly what we don't want. There's lots of, there's a plethora of research on the kidneys that shows the protective measures of having a more plant-based diet. And some of those are less stress on the kidneys, slower progression, if at all, of kidney disease. You got better fiber, so then you got better gut health. And guess what? Your gut can actually produce some toxins that stress your kidneys out, so that helps. Not only that, but having plant-based proteins, because they come in that plant food matrix, they're packed with antioxidants. And those are actually helping to protect your body and your cells, including your kidney cells, against damage. And they're adding components, those anti-inflammatories, in your body that support your immune function and help support kidney health. Also, with more plant-based protein and less animal protein, because it's, you gotta split them out there, your body has less work to do because the diet is less acidic. And all of the research shows that having less protein, which you automatically have less dense protein with animal-based protein, you have decreased bone disease. You have a reduction in protein in your urine, which is huge, which is such a good thing. You have better heart health profiles, better blood pressure. And so all of these things go back into why plant-based is better for kidney disease, let alone for kidney health.
Wow. So you have multiple positive effects of doing plant-based, right? That's really incredible. So it's not just for the kidneys, right? We've got heart health in there as well too, bone health in there. That's very, very important to kind of understand, I think, because, research shows that this has been, a plant-based ketogenic diet has positive effects for those with kidney disease. But I think overall, it's kind of positive for anyone, right? For what I'm understanding in that sense. So I know this is kind of a different discussion, but if maybe you can just talk briefly about whether or not plant-based proteins or animal-based proteins are more bioavailable, right? So which do we tend to absorb more of?
Sure. Now, to compare those side by side, animal-based proteins, and I'm talking meat, are very dense with protein. And so proteins are made up of amino acids. And so speaking of bioavailability, there's different amino acid blends in animal and plant-based. And so an old myth is that you won't be able to meet your needs. And if you don't eat, meat more frequently, you're not going to have bioavailable amino acids and what you need to support your health. Nope. Keyword is a myth. You can get all of your nutritional needs through plant-based protein, and you can get all your essential amino acids. And the key there is to have a variety in your diet of plant-based proteins. Now, when I say, I think it's important to say, a plant-based diet is not a vegetarian diet, always. It's not a vegan diet. It's a diet where your predominant intake is from plants. So everyone knows the Mediterranean diet. Guess what? That's plant-based. You know? And so what's important to look at is which proteins serve you best and which proteins both do those two angles of less stress and waste for your kidneys and positive effect. So looking at the animal versus plant, it definitely is very difficult to have a lot of animal meat in your diet and stay within a healthy amount of protein to not stress your kidneys out.
Right. Yeah. I'm glad you touched on that, Diana. I'm glad you said, you know, it's not a vegan diet. It's not a vegetarian diet. I think a lot of times when somebody hears a plant-based or a plant-focused diet, right, individuals automatically are like, whoa, I can't do that. Or, you know, I don't have enough, you know, plants to eat. Or there's all of these different things, misconceptions that people have. So I'm glad that you kind of, you know, talked a little bit about that. And hopefully that provides a little bit more understanding for individuals as well when you hear those words, right? Great. This has been super helpful, Diana. I don't know if there's any last kind of words or, you know, recommendations that you wanted to talk about before we close
today. Absolutely. So if you're thinking about starting more plant-based, absolutely go for it. You don't have to do it all at once. And so here's what I would recommend. Start today and your kidney function, your overall health function as a person will thank you later. So first I would say, check what exactly are you consuming? Like, what are you consuming animal meat wise? What are you consuming plant-based protein wise? And start there. So know what you're actually eating and base your goals on that. And what I've seen work really well with people I've worked with is try swapping one meal out a time. So take one meal and make it more plant focused and start with things that you like. So take one of those meat heavy meals and try it being plant focused and start with something that you like. And then also, while you're doing that, be aware of your animal meat portions, because that goes back to how much, because those can really add up and impact the work on your kidneys. So do that one meal and then build yourself up to maybe trying a second meal or a second day during the week. Mm-hmm. And from there, you can even branch out and try new recipes or even try a new way of cooking or a new plant protein. So do your steps in gradual goals. It's very doable and every single piece adds up. If you've ever heard of Meatless Monday, they ran that whole campaign to have, you know, one day a week, it's Meatless Monday, to try new stuff out. Well, here's the cool thing is that they followed a bunch of people who had impaired kidney function, who incorporated Meatless Monday, and they saw just in that one day a week, dramatically different results in the progression of their kidney disease. So the whole reason for that story is to say small changes add up to big impact.
Yeah. Thank you for that, Diana. You always have the most encouraging words. And I think that that really helps people to kind of start to, you know, maybe even consider doing something like this, because it's all about those baby steps, right? Change is hard. Everybody has difficulty with change. And so it's about how can I do something and change for myself, right? That works for me. And so I'm really glad that you pointed that out. And always, if you have issues or if you're wanting to start to implement a more plant-focused ketogenic diet, reaching out to a renal dietitian. I think that's the first step to do, because those are more individualized and personal plans that a dietitian can help you with, right? They can help determine exactly what might work best for you, and you can always modify it based on your results or, you know, what you feel is or is not working. So thank you for pointing that out, Diana. That was very, very great. Again, Diana, appreciate you today. As always, you're super insightful on all of these topics. So we always are happy to have you on our channel. And thank you again.
Thank you. Bye, everybody.
Bye.